रश्मि भाई, टू टीचर्स एंड टू गिव अस अ मैच्योरिटी हाउ टू अप्लाई द लॉ एंड ट्रीटी टुगेदर, हाउ टू इंटरप्ले बिटवीन लॉ एंड ट्रीटी, अ नंबर ऑफ इश्यूज यू नो व्हेन यू रियली सिट फॉर एप्लीकेशन ऑफ टैक्स ट्रीटी एज टू whether how to compute the income under a particular head, how to compute taxes whether head wise or a total income to be computed and tax credit to be obtained, how these provisions of treaty are employed to appropriately consider the tax rates and the scope of total income for withholding obligation of 195. That is what we are going to learn from Rashmi Bhai. Now, coming to the present task of introducing Rashmi Bhai, it's a tall claim to introduce him because everyone of knows who is Rashmi Bhai. Rashmi Bhai is a partner of Rashmi Sanghvi and Associates and practicing over last 40 years on the subject of taxation. They only specialize in consulting business. They do not do any traditional or a kind of a practice where we, most of us, are involved. Friends, I don't have to say where he has made presentation and where not. He has made presentation everywhere. But most importantly, he was appointed as a special task group constituted by the Finance Ministry on e-commerce, and the report was submitted by his committee to the Ministry of Finance on e-commerce that how to tax e-commerce activity in very very initial period when the subject was very very little known. Also, he has been the staff faculty at National Academy of Direct Taxes, Nagpur, constituted by the CBDT. And also he has been faculty with UTI Institute for several years. With this, friends, before I present Rashmi Bhai to take over, may I request my president Yatin Bhai to present a memento as a mark of respect to Rashmi Bhai. Thank you, sir. Rashmi Bhai, mic is yours. You can sit there and relax. Yes, sir.
Sorry, I have forgotten to tell you all that most of us have learned FEMA and international taxation from the two stalwarts. One is Dilip Bhai Thakkar and another is Rashmi Bhai Sanghvi. So therefore we all know, and my respect is towards Rashmi Bhai due to that also. And definitely many more students of FEMA and international taxation will learn from Rashmi Bhai. With this, I present Rashmi Bhai.
Thank you, Paresh Bhai. Are you getting the sound?
Yes.
Okay. I agree with Paresh Bhai that I have also learned FEMA from Dilip Bhai. And of course, for international taxation, there were several gurus. There was not one guru. And the biggest benefit, I have traveled in a few countries, I can tell you, nothing like Mumbai. Chamber of Tax Consultants, Institute of Chartered Accountants, Bombay Chartered Accountants Society, IFA, FIT, all the organizations are eager to share the knowledge. This I have not seen in other countries around the world, and even in India. Okay, now there are some cities where they also share knowledge the way we share in Mumbai. But Mumbai is number one in sharing the knowledge. So all of us are beneficiaries of that. Thank you. I have also learned, just like you are sitting there, I have also learned, and I am sharing. I have learned from Pradyuman Bhai, from Mr. V.H. Patil, from so many other seniors. And this is the only way whereby profession continues the cycle of growing knowledge. I am also told by Paresh bhai that there are some CA students here. Can you please raise your hands who are the still students? Very good, very good. Because whenever an article student joins my office, I give them first advice that if you are, whatever exam you are appearing, you first, even before starting your revision, you try to read the questions of one level higher. Try, you will not know the answers of the questions, but read the questions, then try to read the answers. You will not understand things, but your horizons of the mind will open up. You will have a much broader thinking. I mean, what we used to call as, say, intermediate, now it is called IPCC. Okay, so my IPCC students, I would tell them that you learn for final CA students. For my final CA students, I would say that you try to look at the British Institute's paper, try to look at comparable institutes like MBA Institute or whoever is raising issues on taxation, you try to read them. I passed CA some 35 years back. From then and now, almost 60 to 70% syllabus is still the same. And in these 70 exams which would have been conducted by now, every time the student who appears in the exams, he finds question is new. Really, what is new? It is the same question they are asking in a different way. Our institute has acquired a skill of asking a question in an unexpected manner. And when the student is hit with an unexpected thing, he gets nervous, and that is where 80% of the people fail. Because I believe 90% would have really studied well and 90% would probably pass the exams also. It is the nervousness of unexpected questions which hits them. So those students who have come here for an advanced level knowledge, my congratulations to you. Also in my office, this paper has been written by my two students, Isita and Utsav, and I have requested both of them to come here. And we do ensure that these students must learn even before they complete articleship, they must learn what we will be sharing in this workshop. So knowledge is always to be shared. Thank you. These claps are for you, Utsav and Isita. Okay, you had in the morning two sessions by two stalwarts on domestic law, Indian Income Tax Act pertaining to international tax provisions. You may just imagine the situation a few years back. The best book on Indian Income Tax Act is still Kanga and Palkhiwala's book. There is no other book to beat that. Even if you might consider it is outdated, whatever you consider, for the fundamentals of Income Tax Act, that is the best book. For section 90 and 91, the book has got 1.5 pages or 2 pages. And today, meaning there was a time when international tax was not studied by anybody. Not by chartered accountants because it was not part of our syllabus. Not by income tax commissioners, nor by judges. So, we have seen so many decisions which with respect are absolutely incorrect. 20 years back I was talking with one income tax commissioner and he explained in a particular case he had passed an order where 200 crores of revenue was not taxed. And in 10 minutes discussions with me he realized that that 200 crores should have been taxed. They did not have the knowledge of international taxation and people took the income tax commissioner for a big ride. The only difference today is that somebody today takes the department for a ride for 25,000 crores. If you have read papers and you know the case where huge remittances have been made without any deduction of tax at source. How it happens? It's a very serious question one has to ponder. Today, departmental commissioners, at least some of the commissioners whom I know, have much greater knowledge than expert chartered accountants. And yet, even after the elaborate system of TDS and all that, there are companies which get away with remittance of so much huge funds. What we will do is, my role today is to introduce double tax avoidance agreement before you. You have already seen the Income Tax Act, now the treaty that I will discuss with you in the first session. If we can't complete in the first session, then it will go on to the second session after tea break also. But if we can complete the introduction in the first session, then in the second session, I will discuss with you some of the most controversial issues which are engaging the attention of the world's best leaders today. The issues of taxing Google Corporation, the issues of e-commerce taxation, and after telling you what are the current fundamental rules of international taxation in the first session, in the second session I will establish before you that all these rules are wrong. So be prepared for an open mind, absolutely open mind. I only remember that when I was studying BCom 67 to 71, in the first year we had an economic theory like from Malthusian theory and all that. In the second year they will tell us that the first year theory was all bunkum, so this is the new theory. And then the third year they will say second year theory was bunkum and this is the new theory. So today you will have in half a day two sessions where I will present before you principles which have been accepted by Supreme Court of India, even by the Department of India and several governments. And then I will say how these principles are being challenged today. Okay, that is all for the second session. Let us come to, I have got my copy with me and thankfully chamber has printed exactly the same. The point is my page numbers and your page numbers will be different. So when I am referring to my notes, I will just say the paragraph numbers so that you can just have a quick look at it. I am right now on the preface. Since the whole theme of the workshop is taxation of foreign remittances, so I am starting with that. And naturally, foreign remittance means we have to go to tax reduction at source. I will use the short form TDS, and for double tax avoidance treaty, I will use the short form DTA or just treaty. Whenever you want to make a payment to a non-resident of India, what are the actions which you should take? What are the steps you take? I mean, we are all practitioners, either advocates or chartered accountants. So, quite likely it is always the client's payment, not our payment. But when we issue a certificate, what steps we must examine whether the client has taken the steps properly or not? First, is it permissible under PEMA? Because with all the liberalization, Foreign Exchange Management Act is still there. Exchange restrictions are still there. And if we violate PEMA, then there can be serious repercussions. So we have to examine whether this is permitted under PEMA or not. The liberalization under PEMA is that all current account payments are freely permissible. Almost all. And most of the payments where people will come to you for TDS certificates would be current account payment. Capital account payments, there are restrictions. So this first you have to examine what is permissible, what is not permissible, but I will not go into details on PEMA today. The second issue is it income? You know, like the biggest controversy today going on is the Indian subsidiary. No, it was the reverse case. So let us say somebody is making a foreign investment. An Indian company like say Tata Sons, they acquired Corus abroad. Okay, and Tata's, whichever the group company, subscribed to the shares of Corus in Britain. Is it income remittance or is it a capital account remittance? If it is not income, the whole of Income Tax Act does not apply, period. There can be no controversy about it. Let us say the father is making remittance for his daughter's education abroad, or father is making remittance for a family relative maintenance abroad. These are not incomes. these are generally very freely permitted under FEMA, and there is no question about deducting income tax from these payments. So permissibility under FEMA, whether it is income or not, that is the second step. Third, is it taxable? Now I will not discuss Income Tax Act. 90% of the payments which Indians make to foreigners or non-residents are not taxable in India. Why? Let us say our Indian imports are of about $500 billion per year. Out of that, almost $200 billion is for import of oil. Another $250 billion is for import of goods. These are, as admitted by the department, as settled by income, I mean all the courts in India, not liable to tax. When we are importing goods into India, when the foreign supplier has no permanent establishment in India, the payment to the foreign supplier is not liable to income tax in India. It is a settled principle since 1920. So universally, globally, all the courts have accepted this principle. So if it is not taxable, even if it is income of the non-resident, it is not taxable in India, matter ends there. If it is income and if it is taxable in India under the Income Tax Act, then we have to look at the treaty. Under the treaty, is it taxable or is it exempt? It is possible that under the treaty it may be exempt. Then again, you don't deduct tax. If under the treaty also the amount is taxable, then we have to look at what is the rate. And here what people do is they straight away jump to the treaty, look at the rates and apply the rates. Today my attempt is to go into the details. Do we just apply the rate like that, or we consider further details and then only we apply the rates? Okay, I am still on page 1. In fact, sometimes on page 1 only I can take 1 hour. But we will complete almost 30 pages today, so I'll quickly move. What is the, I'm now on page number 2, there are some short forms which are normally known to everybody, but just for clarification I have put up there. First of all, what is a double tax avoidance agreement? We must understand that this is not an agreement between two traders. This is not an agreement between two businessmen. It is an agreement between two governments, each of which is generally a sovereign country. Sovereign country meaning there is no higher authority above the government. Government is government. Government of India is final authority. We are members of United Nations, but it does not mean that government of India has to succumb to United Nations pressures. No. Nobody can dictate to government of India. By government of India here, for this purpose I mean the parliament, the government, the judiciary, all put together, the authority is a sovereign authority. Now let us say India signs an agreement with UK. Now the government of UK is a sovereign government. If one of them violates the conditions of the agreement, then what happens? To whom do you go? Nothing happens. Somebody has violated, he has violated. Now you have the guts, you go on a war with him. If you don't have the guts, or even if you have guts, you don't consider going for a war as an economical proposition, you don't go. Then the only object or only option available to you is cancel the treaty. Okay. Otherwise there is no option. And this always reminds me when almost 35 years back, I was sitting with a very senior executive of a multinational corporation, and he said their company had taken certain facility from Deutsche Bank. The chairman of this MNC and the chairman of Deutsche Bank would be personal friends. Down the line, two executives have transacted some business, and he said our entire agreement was reduced in a one page. There were some 4 or 5 conditions they put down on one page, and that was it. It was not necessary to sign also. Just you put down conditions in writing so that It is possible that after 2 years, after 5 years, you might forget some terms of conditions. Okay. Just for a memory, you put down and both of them have same paper in their lockers or in their files, and if necessary they will refer to the paper. There is no question of one person filing a case against the other. This is called an agreement in good faith. If I borrow money from Paresh Bhai is not going to ask me for signing a bond on 100 rupees stamp paper. Both of us would enter into an agreement which would be oral. We both trust each other and we will fulfill the terms of the agreement. This is called an agreement in good faith. An agreement in good faith where both parties have the desire to follow the agreement in spirit, in substance and in letter of law. This issue which I am emphasizing right now has been elaborated in detail in the Vienna Convention. Vienna Convention is a convention on agreements between governments. And it says an agreement shall be interpreted in good faith and after considering reference and context. Now these two lines, I would request all of you to read Vienna Convention. It is very easily available on the internet and in the chamber's earlier compendium. Right now we have got a 4-volume compendium. In the earlier compendium, it was there, the Vienna Convention. And of course, you want to read more details, you can go on to my website, rasminsanghvi.com, and I have given a detailed article on Vienna Convention. Why I am emphasizing this? Because 90% of the case law which I read today are purely in violation of Vienna Convention. The practitioner does not respect Vienna Convention. He does an aggressive planning. The income tax commissioner does not raise the issue that this is in violation of Vienna Convention, nor does the court raise the issue. In India, today international tax practice is being conducted in gross violation of Vienna Convention, which should not happen. If the income tax commissioner were knowledgeable, and with respect I would say if the judges, judiciary were knowledgeable on this point, so much planning which is going on in international taxation would be struck down at the tribunal level only. Maybe someday the time will come when all the concerned will respect Vienna Convention, with which we are all bound. Okay. Then the tax planning will acquire an entirely different color. So please have a look at it. What is the purpose of double tax avoidance agreement? I see here many people are very senior and probably already experts in international taxation. So kindly pardon me if I go into details. There are students also and there are some people who may not be experts on international taxation. So I am going into some details which experts like you would be already knowing. What is the purpose of the double tax avoidance agreement? Let us say there is one Mr. Patel. He has, under liberalized remittance scheme of FEMA, he has invested say £1,000 in a British bank in London. He has got a fixed deposit. Today of course you don't earn any interest in the entire Europe and USA, but for our illustration we assume that he is earning 5% interest. So he gets £50. Now the British income tax normally, again I don't know the British law, but let us assume it is 30%. So from £50 the British government would charge £15 as income tax on it. When he gets his £35 in India, the Indian government will say your income is £50. And income tax paid is not a deductible expenditure. So Indian government will levy another £15 or 30% tax on £50. This Mr. Patel will end up paying £30 as income tax, 15 to UK government, 15 to Indian government. This is the simplest example where the gentleman suffers 60% tax. Imagine the situation when our income tax rates were 67% or even higher. And even today, in USA the income tax rates can go up to 50%. So if you had an income from USA, you will end up paying 110% tax. So who will do the business? Who will do international investment? It won't happen. Or it will happen underground. It will be under black money transactions. All the governments realize this, and that is why they sign a double tax avoidance agreement, where the two nations who come together to sign the agreement, one nation will say, and now I'll go little more details, the country in which the SSE is resident, let us say it is called country of residence or COR. The other country from which the resident is earning income is the country of source, or in short COS. When COR signs agreement with COS, it means when Mr. Patel has income from Britain, Britain will not levy 30% tax, but will levy only at a reduced rate, let us say 10%. So on the 50 pounds British income, Mr. Patel will pay to Britain only 5 pounds. Then government of India will agree to give credit for that 5 pounds paid in Britain. So the Indian tax is 15 pounds, against that 5 pound is available as credit, and he pays a net tax of 10 pounds to government of India. So he pays only 15 pounds. Normally the exercise will work in such a way that the SSE will pay the higher of the two rates. What is the rate charged by the COS and what is the rate payable in COR, he will end up paying the higher of the two rates. But there will be no double tax. This is the primary purpose of double tax avoidance agreement: eliminate double taxation. I have given you one of the simplest of the illustrations, and by the time we come to second session, you will have one of the most complex illustration. But this simple position, COS restricts its right to levy tax on income earned from its country by a resident of another country. And the COR agrees to give full credit for the taxes paid in COS. This is the primary purpose. Second purpose of the treaty is to avoid tax evasion and tax avoidance. Now this second line was always written in all the double tax avoidance agreement, but always ignored by everyone. Avoidance of tax evasion or tax avoidance, that is also a purpose of the treaty. It was only when in the year 2008 the financial crisis hit USA very badly, then spread to Europe. So I call it Northwestern financial crisis. Europe and USA were affected by it. Rest of the world was not affected except to the extent of consequential effect. People call it global crisis, I call it Northwestern economic crisis. But when that crisis hit, then G20, 20 nations came around. They set up a group and they gave an assignment to OECD that too much tax evasion is taking place and people are abusing double tax avoidance treaties for their tax avoidance plans. So you please take steps. You suggest us a new draft of double tax avoidance agreement. And that draft should take care of the tax avoidance by stalwarts of the world. So that is the second purpose to which people have woken up only some 3 or 4 years back. We have some model conventions: OECD model, United Nations model. These are the two models which generally the world follows. Why do you have a model convention? Would somebody give a response? India has signed agreement with some 70-80 countries. Why should India look at OECD model or UN model? Very simple. When I was doing my articleship and my boss told me that you prepare a partnership deed between A and B, I looked up the file from X and Y, that partnership deed I took, changed the names, and that was the agreement was ready. when you have, and this is a simple thing, but I am saying, let us say you have put in a lot of efforts in drafting a partnership deed or drafting a memorandum and articles of association. When the next case comes to you, you don't have to put up 100% efforts again. At least 70% of the work you, which you can straight away borrow and then make modifications necessary for the new case before you. So a model convention helps you in reducing the labor which you yourself have put up so many times earlier. When India has signed say 70 agreements, when you sign the 71st agreement, you don't get into the entire conversation again. So you take the 70 agreements and then you draft the 71st agreement. Wherever necessary, few clauses may be negotiated. OECD model is generally considered to be pro the rich nations, G4 nations, USA, Britain, France and Germany. These are the nations which dictated immediately after the First World War, these were the victors. They drafted the double tax avoidance agreement model. So it was called at that time League of Nations model. And they drafted, if Britain has to sign agreement with India, in the negotiation, who would win? In the year 1920 and 1930, we were a colony. We had no voice. And there were hardly anybody who would understand what is Income Tax Act. And nobody who would understand what is a double tax avoidance agreement. Now it's a human psychology that the rule maker makes the rules which will favor the rule maker. Right? Even if you are playing a game of playing on some vyapar or mercantile trade or whatever, and if you had to draft rules, supposing I have to draft the rules and four of us are playing, then I'll draft rules where I win the game. This is what has happened in OECD model convention. Then came up United Nations and they took a little bit of favor in favor of the developing countries or people who were other than the G4 nations. G4 then ultimately grew into G7, a club of seven rich nations which included USSR and a few other countries. Anyway, there is a model convention. Is that model convention binding on Indian Income Tax Commissioner? Is it binding on the Indian courts of law? Absolutely no. There is just no question of these agreements being binding on any Indian court. In Chettiar's case, Honorable Supreme Court said, OECD model is not binding on India, we will not look at it. Now I will put another concept that while the agreement OECD model and the commentary by OECD experts on the OECD model, they are not binding on India, they have a tremendous intellectual value. What is the meaning of intellectual value? Let me say, you have got an Indian income tax issue. And late Mr. Palkhiwala in his book has given his opinion that in this case the tax should be like this. Assume further that that particular provision of law has not changed since the commentary was last written. For international taxation, the world best book is by Professor Klaus Vogel. Let us say Professor Klaus Vogel has given his opinion on treaty application and the issue is before a court of law. And Paresh Bhai argues that this is Klaus Vogel's opinion and hence my lord, this should be accepted. Can the court of law say that Klaus Vogel's opinion is not binding on me? Not binding? Yes. But if the court of law wants to give a decision contrary to Klaus Vogel's opinion, it is incumbent upon the court to give a reasoning, a very clear explanation why the court disagrees with Klaus Vogel's opinion. Similarly, I would say whether Klaus Vogel's opinion, late Palkhiwala's opinion or OECD commentary and United Nations commentary. Anybody can reject them. But if you reject, it is necessary that you give full reasoning why you are rejecting it. Not just a cursory rejection. So this is the intellectual value of OECD commentary and United Nations commentary. It is necessary for anyone who wants to make a serious study of international taxation that you please study the OECD commentary. It is very difficult. If you have not attended a workshop like this, I tried to read it and it was all Greek and Latin for me. It takes 2-3 years study in repeated sessions like this, and then if you take up OECD commentary, then you will enjoy the commentary. On page 3, on paragraph 2, I have taken up an issue which is how to read double tax avoidance agreement. Again, when we started in the year 1987, there was nobody who would tell us how to read. So we were just fumbling our way out of it and we could not understand. I had come to conclusion that the experts have written this double tax avoidance agreement in such a manner that nobody can understand, so they maintain their monopoly on international tax practice. The fact is, the way the model is written, today India and UK may copy it, tomorrow India and Argentina may copy it, day after Malaysia and USA may copy it. So they have used common terminology. And this common terminology, when we try to read, it makes it difficult to understand. So I am giving before you just one illustration of one article, one clause. And I am giving a simple technique of you replace a few words and then read again, then the whole thing will make a lot of sense. This is paragraph 2, my page is 4. Under paragraph 2, I have reproduced article 7 in the double tax avoidance agreement. Article 7 is for business profits. How it reads? The profits of an enterprise of a contracting state shall be taxable only in that state unless the enterprise carries on business in the other contracting state through a permanent establishment situated therein. Now, for the first timer, it is difficult to read because they violate the rules of grammar. You know, if you are using Word on your computer, the rule of grammar says, a decent writing says, your sentence should not be of more than 15 words. Here this sentence goes on beyond 30 words. And some of these are compound sentences. And I was lucky, my father taught me English, compound and complex sentences, and how to, you know, break up those phrases, so I could understand. But I remember that grammar was found to be most difficult even in school days. It is difficult to separate the compound, and even today I have seen most chartered accountants, and even nowadays, even the courts, when they write a compound sentence, undoubtedly they make mistakes in grammar. But of course OECD does not make any mistake in it, but it becomes a complex sentence. Now you replace the words contracting state and the other contracting state. Okay, let us say I have taken illustration, you go to the bottom of the page, paragraph small 2, article 7, simplified, where I am writing, the profits and enterprise of India shall be taxable only in India unless the enterprise carries on business in UK through a permanent establishment situated in UK. Now it makes more sense. What we have done is simply replace the words, which are confusing words. This can be even further simplified. We can say, the profits of Tata will be taxed only in India unless Tata carries on a business with a permanent establishment in UK. How simple it becomes. Say Indian Hotels has got a hotel in London. This, for a moment, you assume that there is no subsidiary and Tata's have got a branch in London. So the profits, the Taj Mahal Hotel, which is based in India, or so many other hotels owned by Tata Group working in India, their profits will be taxable only in India. What is new about it? It's simple logic. There should be no complexity. So Tata, which is an Indian enterprise, their profits will be taxable only in India. Very simple statement. However, If Tatas have got a permanent establishment in UK, then the profits attributable to that permanent establishment can be taxed in UK. Isn't it simple? Very simple. When you have a case before you, you replace a few words by the name of the country and replace the few words by your client's name, and the entire treaty becomes very simple. Country of source and country of residence I have already discussed, so paragraph 3 I will not talk more. We go to the paragraph 4. Understanding double tax avoidance agreement in entirety becomes far more easy when we recognize the structure of the treaty. What is the structure of the treaty? First, articles 1 and 2 provide for the applicability of the treaty. Same way as section 1 provides for jurisdiction of Indian Income Tax Act. I can give a guarantee that no chartered accountant and no advocate spare more than 1 minute in reading section 1. Who spends time on section 1? In the biggest case of 11,500 crore tax avoidance by Vodafone was based on section 1. 11,500 crores of tax avoidance based on section 1. That is one line sentence. The relevant line is 1. We don't give importance to it. Have a fresh look at the Indian Income Tax Act. This is necessary the moment you practice on international taxation or you study on international taxation. The provisions which we all of us have ignored suddenly acquire huge importance. Why? Because for an Indian resident, jurisdiction is not important. Whatever he earns in India or whatever he earns from outside India is taxable in India. So why read section 1? Why read section 4, 5, 6, 9? His global income is taxable in India. And most of us have 100% of our clients who are Indian residents. So we never bother about sections 1 to 9. The moment you start practice on international taxation, these sections 1 to 9 acquire maximum importance. This is what the stalwarts V.S.P. Patel and Sushil Bhai, they have discussed with you. So I will not discuss more on it except highlighting the importance of it. We are coming back to the treaty. Articles 1 and 2 provide for the applicability of the treaty. If treaty is not applicable, you cannot take the benefit of the treaty. Articles 3 and 5 provide for definitions. Article 4 refers to residential status. And mark my words, Article 4 does not define residential status. Article 4 of the treaty takes you to the definition provided under your domestic law. But we'll come discuss little later. Then Articles 6 to 22. This is a whole group of articles is on categorization of incomes. For example, Article 6, income from immovable property. Article 7, business income. Article 8, shipping income. And so on, royalties and fees for technical services and salary income and all kinds of different incomes. All this categorization is applicable only for the COS. Only for the country of source, these categories are important. If we discuss that Tatas have got set up a hotel, they have got a steel plant in UK, and now they have got automobile plant. And you must be knowing already that the automobile plants which Tatas have taken over, they were making losses for last 20 years. And once Tatas took over, within 2 to 3 years, they have broken even and now they are making profits. For our discussion, we ignore the corporate structure. Let us say these are direct ownership of Indian company. Then what will be the tax impact? The country of source will be UK. The country of residence is India. The country of source will determine whether this is business income, whether this is royalty, whether this is fees for technical service. All the categories will be decided by the country of source. Having determined the category, that country will decide either to levy the full tax or to levy a restricted tax on the gross income or not to tax it. These three kinds of decisions, whether to levy the full tax, whether to levy a concessional tax, or whether to exempt the income of the non-resident, are to be taken by the country of source. So 6 to 22 by UK, in our illustrations, UK will decide. Then all those incomes come to Bombay House, the Tata Group. Now it is for India to give credit for the taxes paid in UK. So for India it is Article 23, elimination of double taxation, nothing else. India is not bothered about what is the category of income in UK. Whatever income Tatas have earned in UK, that is all taxable in India. And from that income, you deduct the taxes, from that Indian tax payable by Tatas, you deduct the taxes payable in UK. Let me just again clarify, I am oversimplifying everything. And then when we go into the second session, I will say how tax avoidance games are being played. That is a complexity aspect. But here right now, I am simplifying so that we understand what is the treaty, how it operates. Article 23 provides for elimination of double taxation, which has to be implemented, administered by the country of residence, in our illustrations by India. There are 2-3 systems of international taxation worldwide. India, USA, UK, Germany, all these countries have accepted a classical system of taxation, which means they claim that their residents are liable to their tax. Let me use the simple language. India claims that all Indian residents are liable to Indian tax on their global income. We will give credit for the foreign taxes paid, but we will not exempt foreign income. This is called the classical system of taxation. Singapore, Hong Kong and France, they have accepted territorial system of taxation. They say whatever income, let us say talk of Singapore. The government of Singapore says even a proper resident of Singapore will be liable to Singaporean income tax only if he earns income from Singapore. So a person who is resident of Singapore earns income from India, then primarily it is not taxable in Singapore. Then there is a further section which says, however, if the Indian income is remitted into Singapore, then Singapore may levy tax on it. I am not an expert on Singapore taxation. I am just giving you an illustration. I am told Singapore has now made further changes in this system so that even on remittance, the income is not taxable in Singapore. Hong Kong has got similar treaty, similar system of taxation, territorial system of taxation. These things will be helpful in further understanding the distinction between a classical system of international taxation and territorial system of international taxation. How does the treaty actually operate? Page 7 or paragraph 6, I have already explained to you. So we will move forward. Okay, now paragraph 7, I am coming back to article 4. I have selected this because I myself found it very difficult to understand what is article 4. If you read the article, it says, a person shall be deemed to be resident of a country if he is resident of that country. What does it mean? In Excel sheets, we have circular calculations. If you make an error in that your formula, then the computer goes on and on and on, and you will never get an answer. The rules of English grammar say that while defining a word, you cannot use the same word. Right? Now, what are they doing here? I said all these things just to make a joke out of it. Factually, the position is like this. The OECD model and United Nations model say that a person shall be treated for the purposes of the treaty to be a resident of a country if, under the domestic law of that country, he is considered to be liable to tax in this country by virtue of his residence, citizenship, domicile or other similar criteria. Now let me simplify this sentence. India considers residential, we are discussing, let us say, only individuals for the time being, then we can go to other issues. India considers an individual to be resident in India if he is physically present in India for 182 days or more. Now he may have come to India as a tourist. He loved India and he stayed here for 7 months. That is not relevant. The fact that he has stayed in India for more than 6 months, he is Indian resident. Somebody may be Indian resident right from birth. He goes abroad for studies and he is out of India for more than 6 months. He is non-resident, period. Under Income Tax Act, intention, cause, reason, purpose, all these words are irrelevant. And believe me, Section 6.1 is the simplest definition in the world for residential status. Indian Income Tax Act is one of the simplest Income Tax Act in the world. Tell me how many people agree with me.
Thank you sir.
I am not counting city countries. You know, Singapore is a city country, Hong Kong is a city country. They don't bother about income tax. So their laws would be simple. But in United States, for example, residential status is decided by citizenship or green card. If you have a green card, you are a resident of that country. If you are a citizen of USA, you are a resident of that country. Then even if you may be out of USA for 5 years at a stretch, you are still resident of USA and global income is taxable in USA. Now be prepared for anekantvad. You know what is anekantvad? Of course the seniors know here. It means every person thinks differently. The principle, this is an Indian philosophy, tunde tunde matir binna, means every individual thinks differently. Many of you may be hopeful or may have a dream of getting a US green card and then getting US citizenship. Okay, I have clients who want to give up US citizenship. Why? Because in fact I know so many cases, people are US citizens. For last 20 years they are staying in India, they have not given up US citizenship. On their death, their estate will be liable to US estate duty. They call it inheritance tax and it is at the rate of 40%. Earlier it was 50%. Now just imagine, when J.R.D. Tata died, okay, he had value of, let's say, $100 billion worth of shares in all the Tata Group companies. If Ratan Tata had to pay $40 billion in inheritance tax, what would happen? No industrialist on earth can have 40% of the share values as liquid assets. It's not possible. Even if he may be staying in a palace, what will be the value of palace compared to the shares of Tata Consultancy Services? Okay. So Ratan Tata would go into the market to sell the shares of TCS, TISCO, Telco to pay the estate duty on J.R.D. Tata's death. What will happen in the market if Ratan Tata is selling TISCO shares? The shares will go down to less than 30% of its market value. So even if Ratan Tata sells away entire Tata venture, he will still not be able to pay estate duty on J.R.D. Tata's death. And India had 85% estate duty rate. Can you imagine? Who would pay 85% estate duty? In the year 1984, Estate Duty Act was abolished. So you don't have to study it. We normally in our syllabus it was there and most of us tried to take it out in option because nobody understood it.
Only one professor.
Nair Sahib. Nair Sahib was master on it, absolute master. That was a very complex estate duty act, and at the end of the day, government was getting 10 crores in revenue in estate duty. It was a useless law, so most of the people would have black money rather than have white money. But while India has abolished estate duty act, abolished gift tax act, and our wealth tax act is now, wealth tax rate is 1%, where Ratan Tata's entire wealth in share would be exempt, which may be today huge, huge property. It is all exempt under wealth tax. USA continues with almost 55% of income tax rate, 40% of estate duty. Now tell me, which nation is more liberal? The Internal Revenue Code of USA has more than 2000 sections. And nobody in USA, the best tax expert in USA, nobody can claim that he understands the whole of Income Tax Act. It is far more complex than Indian Income Tax Act. UK law is far more complex than Indian Income Tax Act. UK also has got inheritance tax, and people keep fumbling about the correct interpretation of UK inheritance tax. My submission is, and this I have made a submission, that India is better than most other countries in a lecture where the participants were all commissioners of income tax. And I said it is better rate wise and better law wise, and they found it very difficult to accept. And then I had to explain with all the reasoning and illustrations that yes, India is better. You want to break for tea? Yeah, I think friends, we will break for tea and then again
we
will meet.
Yeah, we will break for tea. We can bring tea inside also and reassemble in 10 minutes.
Thank you.